warning. For both men and women, having a rare sleep disorder and managing its treatment is a challenge. But for women, it can be especially complicated as they make decisions about contraception, pregnancy, breastfeeding, and other issues unique to women. They must also take into account their medications they take that further sleep disorder. How might these medications interact with other choices they make? We're so fortunate to have Professor Isabel Arnav here today to share her research on this subject. Having authored more than 150 publications in peer-reviewed scientific journals, Professor Arnav is not only one of the world's leading experts on all forms of hypersomnia, including narcolepsy, idiopathic hypersomnia, and Klein-Levin syndrome, but also professor of neurology at the Sorbonne Université and head of the sleep disorder service at the Pitié-Salpêtrière University Hospital in Paris, France. She trained with Dr. Michel Jouvet, who studied the function and mechanism of REM sleep soon after its discovery, and completed a professional postdoctoral fellowship with Dr. Emmanuel Mignot at Stanford University. Dr. Arnav is the past president of the French Sleep Society. Please join me in welcoming Professor Arnav.
Thank you very much for this kind introduction. Thank you. I must confess I have a few relationship of interest, being a speaker bureau of UCB and a consultant for Novartis, and I've also been investigator in developing several psychostimulants. So what we know is that 50% of patients with narcolepsy are women, which means that half of them are men. This is for narcolepsy, but when it comes to idiopathic hypersomnia, it's 66 to 75% of patients who are women. So it's clearly a female predominant disorder, and whatever the theory of patients. We don't know why. We have no idea about abnormal hormones in women with hypersomnia. What we looked at in our series of 200 patients with IH compared to a narcolepsy type 1 patient is to compare the age at puberty, both in... You can see that the age at puberty is younger in women than in men, but it's the same in IH and in narcolepsy, whether being a man or a woman. So it does not come from at least this part of the sexual development. So, if you mind, we will cover together the problem of birth control, then how to be a mother with IH, and the parenthood in general, and a few words about menopause with IH. So, let's speak about birth control in IH and narcolepsy. First, you know all the drug. I put the drug we have in France. I think you have almost the same. Armodafinil, methylphenidate, sodium oxybate, amphetamine, you have Adderall there that I didn't put, pitolizant, the anti-H3 drugs. All these drugs are used in narcolepsy, but we also use it in IH, so to the, almost the same degree. So if we look on the other hand, the contraceptive methods we have, there are the hormonal methods that you can see here, and it's constituted of estrogen and progestine, and sometimes progestine alone. And all these drugs have a theoretical effect on preventing pregnancy, but in the real life, it's often different, so we call it pragmatic. So you can see all these percentages that are given by our government. Combine estroprogestative normal dosage is efficacious, gives an efficacious contraception in 99.7% of the patient, but in regular use, because you can forget the pill one day or some days, it's only 91% of contraception. It means that 9% of the women will have a child in the next year. And it's the same for combine low dose of estroprogestative for progestin only, that is also called the mini pill. But vaginal rings also contain estroprogestative, and they are submitted to the same level of efficacy, as is the transdermal patch. And the implant, by definition, has only a theoretical effect because you cannot, it's in you, so you cannot forget it. And that's nice. Then, on the other end, you have what we call the barrier methods, which is either a Dutch cap, you know, a diaphragm with permeside inside. And you can see the percentage of contraception is lower in pragmatic use, it's 88%. Intrauterine device is 99.9, and it's in you, you cannot forget it. Condom is a good contraception, 98%, unless it broke. It breaks, so when it breaks, it's 85%. Withdrawal is the oldest technique used by men, but as you see, it can be, in pragmatic use, not very efficacious. And the temperature method had been used in the 50s, even in the 19th century, and it's now called the semptothermia. It means that women are following both their temperature here, as you can see, so that it increases at time of ovulation here, but also they monitor their vaginal phlegm, and you can see the phlegm. If it's very difficult to extend it, it means that it's blocking the spermatozoid, and then it's very fluid. It helps the spermatozoid to go to the uterus. So some women are combining that, and there is quite a revival in France of this method because there is, I'm sure you have the same in US, many young women don't want to take the pill. They think it's not natural. So we have to explain as doctor that it's not natural, but it's working. Anyway, everybody is fine to choose her methods. So what happens with the interaction between the drug you take for IH or narcolepsy and the contraception? There is one drug reducing the effect of the estroprogestative pills. This is modafinil and armodafinil, which is almost the same, because this drug interacts in the liver site where the hormones are destroyed. And it increases their destruction by 30 to 50%. This is the problem. So if you have a lower dose of hormones into you, you have a lower contraception. So if you are using modafinil or armodafinil, the single drug, that hormonal drug that you can take for contraception is a normal dose combined EP, which means you have 40 to 50 micrograms of estradiol in it. The low dose cannot be used alone. The progestin cannot be used alone. Vaginal ring and transdermal are exposed to the same problem. For implants, there is an advantage, is that it's working, but it's working for a shorter time. So the alternative contraception for a woman treated with modafinil or armodafinil is to take either a pill with a normal dose of estroprogestin, containing at least 40 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol. And I don't know if you have this pill in US. We had it in France, but they stopped the it was called Stedyril, but they stopped the manufacturing 2 years ago. So the gynecologist have to make a new estroprogestative combination using an estradiol and progestin combined together, but it's not in the same pill. The alternative we ask to the reference center for contraception in my hospital is to take 2 tablets of a low dose, not a mini dose, low dose pill containing 20 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol and levonorgestrel. For example, Lilou, which is the most prescribed pill in France, and it's the cheapest one. It's 2 tablets per day instead of 1 tablet. So it's easy. And the implant can be used, but it will be effective only for 2 and not for 3 years. So you have to change it more rapidly. Then all barrier methods are compatible with modafinil and armodafinil. Including so the Dutch cap, of course, but the intrauterine device can be used too, even the one with hormones. I have to specify that some intrauterine device contains some progestin inside, which is used to reduce the bleeding associated with intrauterine device. It's not used for a contraceptive purpose. It's just to reduce the bleeding. So you can take it with modafinil or armodafinil, because you will have still a reduced bleeding, probably more, little more than over women, but not that much. And condom can be used. I put withdrawal and symptothermia in gray because they are less efficacious. Now, this problem with interacting with hormone and modafinil also apply to emergency contraception, plan B. If you had unprotected sex or failed birth control and need to take the morning after pill when being continuously treated with modafinil or armodafinil, don't forget you have to double the dosage of the day after pill to ensure birth control. Otherwise, you're not sure of the contraceptive effect. And remember, it's called the day after or the morning after, but it can be taken immediately after the sex. If you had a broken condom, for example, you don't have to wait the next morning, take it immediately. And if you forgot and don't know, you have 5 days to use it. So this is quite practical, at least. So twice the dose, emergency contraception, remember, when you're on modafinil. And this is a little trick some of my patients use. In IH and narcolepsy, patients are really tired. And if you have some severe bleeding during menstruation, you can enchain the blister. When you are too tired at the end of a cycle and do not want to have menstruation to prevent fatigue, do not stop the pill and resume the next blister immediately. It will avoid bleeding and possible associated lack of iron. And this method has been tested, and it's safe, efficacious, and it has been tested for 3 blisters in a row, and then you can have your 7 days of stopping and resume again. So know it, because some women have really some hard menstruation, and they are so tired that you can suppress them with no health effect. Now, from this birth control takeaways, you remember, if treated with modafinil or armodafinil, the pills should contain ethinyl estradiol 40 to 50 micrograms plus a progestin. Norgestrel doubles the dose too. It's a progestin. And or barrier method or intrauterine device. And when on modafinil, taking the morning after pill for unprotected sex or broken condom, double the dosage. And if treated with Ritalin, Xyrem, or Wakix, do what you want for birth control, but choose it efficacious, because we will review the problem with pregnancy with it. Speak of all that with your gynecologist. Then, let's go to pregnancy. When we discussed some following patients for 24 years, and I know them when they were teenagers, having their first boyfriend, speaking of contraception, then the husband, then the kid. So we had a lot of questions. And the first one is, will I transmit my disorder? And I want to mention something that is sometimes not well understood by patients about narcolepsy. Sometimes you read it's a genetic disorder. So people think that they will transmit it to their children. So how many cases are there with an affected father and mother and an affected kids with narcolepsy, cataplexy? You can see a review of all the literature on that topic here, and see in whatever the number of patient and probant, the percentage of another affected member in the family is 1 to 2%. And this is whatever the first degree person. It can be your brother, your sister, your father, or your child. So when you look at Mignot review, 1 to 2% of subjects with narcolepsy have an affected kindred, vertical or horizontal, which means that if you are just considering your children, it's a more than 99% chance not to transmit the disorder. And it's important to say. And the Ohio asked to the family of 157 Italian subjects with narcolepsy, he He called all the probands one by one and asked for symptoms by phone. So remember, it's a phone diagnosis, it's not a medical diagnosis. And he found that 4% of the children interviewed with a parent with narcolepsy reported some symptoms of sleepiness, not cataplexy, of course. So it means that with narcolepsy, you have 96% chance not to transmit symptoms of sleepiness. And in our series, we are following 673 patients with narcolepsy, and we have only 4 families with a parent and a child affected, which is even higher. So please, if you have narcolepsy, make children. No risk. Now, I feel I will have the question for idiopathic hypersomnia, and unfortunately, there is no reliable information on that subject. I'm sure some of you have another kindred affected, but this has not been studied in the general population of IH patients, and long sleep is highly transmitted, so it's hard to know if it's IH or long sleep which is transmitted. Now, if there is a project of pregnancy, we prefer to speak it before the pregnancy has started, to speak about treatment that can be kept and those that have been to stop. So this is an example of an email I received last year. Dear doctor, I don't know her. So my name is Valentine, I'm 28 years old, and I've been medicated since I am 15 years old for narcolepsy with cataplexy. Every day I take modafinil and valafaxine. Valafaxine is for cataplexy. It was difficult at first to accept my disorder, and I'm sure that it's difficult for everybody to accept the disorder. But now, I don't pay much attention to it. Treatment works. However, I want to be pregnant. Sorry, it's a bad translation. I want to be pregnant, and I'm getting conflicting advice. My gynecologist said it was not necessary to stop my regimen. My neurologist said I should stop taking my medication immediately. I use a computer for work, and without the medication, I would be unable to do my job. I'm also worried I would be depressed if I had to go off my med and stay at home during the pregnancy. Could I have a second opinion? Should I half my dosage, and do I need to stop my medication entirely? So, who is right, the gynecologist or the neurologist, in your opinion? I'm happy you think we are right, but I think the gynecologist, yeah, because the gynecologists are always facing the problem of drug, all the time. And the gynecologist, in her case, follows the recommendation of the National Site for Pregnancy, which is something made by doctor and government. In France, it's called Locrat. I'm sure you have the same in US. And you can put the drug on it and look at what is known. Because if you look just at the notice of the company, everything is forbidden. But with time, the government and the health ministry have developed some registries to know, because there are always some pregnancy on drugs. You cannot always schedule everything. So there are recommendations for some of these drugs, modafinil, pitolizol and GHB have not yet any recommendation on the site. Ritalin has some and amphetamine has some. And they distinguish taking the drug during the embryo period, which is during month 1 and month 2 of the pregnancy. And it's a time where the embryo is making his organs, is making his kidney, his liver. And then there is a fetal period from month 3 to month 9, during which it's growing. But the higher vulnerability period is during the 2 first months, because it's the time of building the organs. And they compare all what is known about pregnancy under modafinil, under Ritalin, compared to the normal rate of birth defect. And you know what? There is no zero risk for any pregnancy, even without any drug human make have some birth defect babies. And the percentage is around 2% of pregnancy that is conducted to the end. So each time the government with registry is comparing how much birth defects are in the general untreated population, and with a specific drug in exposed women, is the risk higher or lower? It's how they do. So it's not, it does not come from the company. It comes from a registry, a national registry, from all doctors seeing pregnancy under drugs. So what they say for modafinil and pregnancy is what we know from study in animal, and we know that there were no birth defects in non-human animals, which is first very good news. And then they say that data of women exposed to modafinil during pregnancy at both state, embryo and fetus, is small but reassuring. No problem yet. They don't give the numbers. They say around 100 in France. Now you probably have much more here. During pregnancy, the recommendation is if stopping the drug seriously worsens the patient condition, it is not justified to stop it during pregnancy. And this recommendation is held since 10 years now, so we have implemented it in our patient population. So if pregnant when on modafinil, reassure everybody that there have not been no proven risk of birth defect, and as usual, inform the delivery team. So since this advice 10 years ago, we say that to the patient, some wants to stop, which is perfectly respectable, and some don't want because they cannot live without it, and we leave it. And consequently, we suggest the following. If routine life is not possible without a stimulant, because you work, because you drive, and you drive a car, being sleepy is much more dangerous, or because you have severe symptoms and you're already on modafinil, keep it, no change of dose. They don't recommend to split the dose. They say it's, if you give it, you give it. No change in the dose. Using other stimulant, I recommend to switch to modafinil before pregnancy. So it's part of the plan we have together. That's why I want to see my patient before the beginning of pregnancy. If some are on Ritalin or amphetamine, I ask them to switch to modafinil, and we leave the modafinil during pregnancy. But I recommend stopping it 2 weeks before delivery, because when the baby is in you, it's your kidney and your liver which is eliminating the drug. But when the baby is born, it's out of you, and he still has for five, seven days of modafinil in his blood, on his little kidney and little liver, so it's difficult to eliminate for him. So I prefer they stop it 2 weeks before delivery, because it's time usually when you are on maternity leave, to avoid getting overdosed with modafinil after birth. And if routine life is feasible without any stimulant, stop the medication, but avoid driving a car, rest as often as you can, and take early maternity leave, which is probably not possible in every country. I've learned before that you had only 3 weeks of maternity leave here. 6 weeks? 8? Okay. Okay. And as physician, we should report every pregnancy where the mother is taking medication to this center, because the more information we will have on normal national database, the better for the future mother. We will know better about this risk. And you know, the higher number of exposed people and the more you know. So please contact. So this is what we do with the CRAT. This is baby Luca, and mother I had IH, and she was modafinil. That's what I report to the center, national center. She was on 300 milligrams of modafinil. They conceived the baby in August. She was on modafinil since 2012, and she stopped it 2 weeks before terms. So there was a normal delivery on term, and then I gave all the constant of the baby. It's 3 kilo. Abgar is a score of, and I saw him at 2 months, and he's communicative, he's holding his head. And I have to monitor progress every year to say to have the longest time of information for other women, because there are immediate problems that you can see since birth, but we don't know for the long term, so we have to implement. So I have now some patients with 10 years old babies that have been exposed to modafinil, and it was safe. It was, I mean, we need more, of course, to know, but we have to report. So for methylphenidate and pregnancy, they say that there is no birth defect in non-human animal, and that data of women exposed to methylphenidate during pregnancy are numerous and reassuring. But because of the amphetamine properties of methylphenidate, they ask to take an alternative treatment. So we follow. We stop Ritalin and we switch them to modafinil. For pitolisant is a new WAKIX drug. There has been some birth defect in one animal species. There have been some unwanted pregnancy and unscheduled, wanted but unscheduled pregnancy, and they gave birth to normal baby, but it's only two, so you cannot play with that. So it's contraindicated to be stopped until we have more information. Stopped, and it's five days to be eliminated from the body. For sodium oxybate, there were no information on the site. I sent a mail, but I don't yet have any information, so we use only the company information, which indicate that there is a risk of miscarriage. In animal exposed to sodium oxybate, there were more early miscarriage than in non-exposed animal. And they say there could be more early miscarriage in women exposed to sodium oxybate. So I would recommend to avoid exposure during the first 2 months. It's scheduled as risk B here in US, meaning that the problem is during the 2 months, and then after it's there's no evidence of abnormality in the fetal period. But again, not many information, so no information, I would say avoid, anyway. So the problem is that except for modafinil and some anticataplectic drugs, the key problem will be when we decide to be pregnant, when do you stop the medication? In all women, the average time between the desire to start a pregnancy and real pregnancy is on average 6 months. I've been pregnant immediately after having stopping the pill for my two children, but my sister needed 2 years to get pregnant. So I wish you are like me, but it changes. we don't know our fertility. So you have to either to stop and wait, but it's nice if you know about how long you can take your drug until it is dangerous for the egg. And the conception occurs for women between the 11th and the 18th days of the cycle. It's on average the 14 days. And then it's not immediately that there is an implantation of the egg. You have here an uterus. Here it's the ovary making the oocyte, the ovula, and then when you got sex, the spermatozoid are coming here, and they meet the egg here, in the, we call that the trump of Fallop. Is it the same name in your trump like trump? Yeah, okay, trump like trump. And then the new embryo, the fertilized egg, is not implanted yet. It's floating here in the trunk and making a small journey, day one, day two. Meanwhile, it's dividing, making more and more cells. And then at day eight, it's implanting inside the uterus at the place where it will develop as an embryo and a fetus. So there is 8 days during which the fertilized egg is doing its organs, but it's not exposed to your blood and to your drugs. So I call it the safety zone. So let's make it clearer. That's day one of your cycle. D28 for regular women with regular menstruation should appear here. And during the beginning of the cycle, you have no egg, no ovocyte. Then you make your egg, and it can be fertilized by the spermatozoid between day 11 and day 18. Then it's not implanted until 19, if you have ovulate at 11, at the 11th day, and 26 day of your cycle if you're ovulating here. As soon as the egg is implanting in the uterus, you start to make some BTHCG hormone, which makes a blue test positive. So the test is positive when it's implanted, not before. Okay? So if you can start to determine your ovulation time with temperature, and then to use a positive blue test as soon as the 19 days of your pregnancy of your cycle to know if you're pregnant or not. So we have this safety zone for drugs. Now, the drugs that you are using are not eliminated in one day, except for Xyrem, from your body. They are eliminated after 5 half-life. The half-life is different from one drug to another. The shortest half-life is Xyrem. You know, Xyrem is eliminated very quickly. It's less than 4 hours, sometimes 6 hours. So 5 times 6 hours, it's, if you take the maximum, it's 30 hours. So it's 1 day and a half, even lower than that. So this drug can be taken quite late in the cycle. And then methylphenidate is eliminated between 4 and 6 days. And pitolisant and modafinil are the longest. You have also 5 to 7 days of elimination. So if you're pregnant, it's okay. If you're not pregnant, you can restart it at every cycle. It's how our patients are doing if they cannot stop it. So I would recommend to monitor your central temperature if you have a pregnancy project, to localize your ovulation time over 3 months. And then when you know your ovulation time, you can stop Xyrem between the 19th and 26th days of your cycle and pitolisant the 11th. If you want to stop modafinil, you're not obliged, 11th day as well. If you have very irregular cycle, you cannot use this method. You have to stop the drug very soon, 10 days of the cycle. Now, you may use antidepressant either for cataplexy or for concomitant depression. And what we know for pregnancy is that the oldest is the safest, clomipramine. It's one that we use for severe cataplexy. It's the oldest drug, and there have been numerous use cases during pregnancy. And there is a low risk of withdrawal for infant at birth, even for those higher than used in narcolepsy. And it can be used during breastfeeding because the amount that goes in the milk is very low. So it's safe for cataplexy to keep people on clomipramine. Then using the most common SSRI or SNRI, there's a lot of data with no birth defect, but there's signal on the site too that there is a risk of withdrawal for infant. There are transient, not severe syndrome of withdrawal in children, including tremor, hyperexcitability, sleep disorder, lack of muscle tone and difficulty eating, so that they recommend that the delivery would be in a kangaroo unit. I'm sure you have the kangaroo unit too. It's for special delivery where there is more monitoring. You don't stay 1 or 2 days at the hospital. You stay 4 days, and they are monitoring better the child. So it needs that your neurologist and is interacting with the gynecologist for delivery. Maternity leave, as we said before, if medication is stopped and mother is too tired for continue working, in case of disorder like narcolepsy or hypersomnia, it's possible in France to have a paid. We are so short country, at least, during 9 months. So I always tell my patient, when you're pregnant, phone me, call immediately, and then I stop you for 9 months. You would do what, 1 or 2 babies in your life? Huh? That would be... 2 times 9 months leave, that's not a big deal in regard of doing these things. My experience is, when pregnancy starts, is that the fatigue of the pregnant woman is much more accepted by the society and understood by the society than the fatigue of hypersomnia. Because pregnant women are working for the humanity. So everybody tells, oh, rest, please make your child rest. I wish you would hear that during all your life, because I think the sleepiness of pregnancy has nothing to do with the sleepiness of hypersomnia. So it depends from one case to another. Some are better during pregnancy, probably because of the hormone, and some are worse because of stopping the medication. It's very different from a woman to another. And then, if you have to remember the takeaway, if treatment is needed, the safest compromise is modafinil plus clomipramine if cataplectic. And clomipramine can be taken during breastfeeding. It's advisable to stop the modafinil 2 weeks before delivery, advisable to stop methylphenidate, Xyrem and pitolisant, and there's this risk B that I see in US, that Xyrem can be taken after the start of the third month. Now, the gynecologist writes me, dear colleague, one of your patients, Mrs. C, is pregnant and under my care. She's 25 years old. She's 24 weeks of pregnancy, and this is her first pregnancy. Do you treat her for narcolepsy? Are there any specific risk for delivery? Which is good interaction that we have. Sincerely. So to answer her, I have the recent study made in Europe. We interviewed all our female patients who had pregnancies, and there were 246 responders, and some of them had the pregnancy and child before having developed narcolepsy, and some had it after, and some had child before and child after. And what was interesting in this large series is that for delivery, there were no difference between narcolepsy and non-narcolepsy women. It was spontaneous in most cases, triggered in one-fourth of the cases. CESAR was not more used in narcolepsy than in non-narcolepsy women. And there was only 1% of case of cataplexy during delivery. And the weight and the size of the newborns was the same in both groups, in both pregnancies. Then after birth, babies were more often to breastfeed if mother was narcoleptic, almost 80%, and for a longer time. Note that these data were obtained in European country where it's easy to have some leave when you have a child. And there were also USA bonds by a Jet Black study with 9,000 people reported to have narcolepsy in US, at least on a registry, and they were compared to healthy control, and there were no difference for pregnancy, delivery, and perinatal period. So I responded to the gynecologist, pregnancy and delivery for narcoleptic women is the same as for any woman. There are no added risks except maybe to use extra care when giving the baby to the mother for the first time, because you can have a cataplexy of happiness. Now baby is there. Should we breastfeed he or her or use formula? As you know, drugs are passed down in mother's milk. And this is true for modafinil, methylphenidate, and sodium oxybate, but it has a short half-life. Pitolisant, venlafaxine, fluoxetine, clomipramine is allowed. So it is okay to resume stimulant when done with breastfeeding, except for clomipramine and sodium oxybate with some caution. And this is a recent study that has been conducted by a woman having narcolepsy and Xyrem, and she accepted to have some measure in her milk, taking either 3 grams twice a night or 4.5 grams twice a night. And as you can see, the level of Xyrem were almost undetectable before she takes the Xyrem. The small dosage, 3 gram increase after intake, and here after the second intake too, which is expected because they accumulate, and it's same but higher for higher dosage. And you can see that this is 7 in the morning, so it's still high, then 10, 11, 16, it resumed to lower dosage, and even with 3 grams, there is nothing in the milk here the next day. So, from this experiment, what do we know? The milk of the evening is okay for the baby before taking the first intake. No breast milk at night for the baby, use formula at that moment. And the first milk of the morning should be pump and dump, and except for the was using only a single dose of Skyrim, in that case you can give the milk, then breastfeed the baby all day long. So it's interesting. This woman, we should thank her to have given this information for breast milk. Then you know that babies are hypersomniacs. They sleep in beds. And I would recommend sleep when the baby sleeps. My grandmother used to say, you have to be like a cow in the grass. You make your milk, you and you care of your baby, and you sleep, and everybody's caring for the rest. Be quiet as a cow in a cow, sorry, I'm not saying it well. But you know that we are all exhausted with these babies because it's a lot of care, and this is not an hypersomniac woman, it's a normal woman, and she's exhausted with her baby as shown there. So the question of my patients are always the same: what if I fall asleep or I have a cataplexy when breastfeeding or feeding the baby? There are many solutions for that. This includes breastfeeding in a lying position, like you can see here, and using also this, I don't know how you call them, slides. Okay, so you can use them to either breastfeed or give the formula, and the baby will be safe, which is important because it can be long to breastfeed. Some children are taking their time, so you might fall asleep, and it happens to every woman, every mother, believe me, even non-hypersomniac. And the mother doesn't have to feed the baby all the time. Get help from the partner and family. I would say it's extremely important to have a supporting partner and family when having this project. And remember, it's easy to pump the mother milks and to put it in the fridge or the freezer. Somebody else can give it to the baby when the mother sleeps or is too tired. Use it. It's easy. It's very easy to pump your milk. And it's done for centuries. So, parenting with idiopathic hypersomnia may be a problem. For example, a recurrent question is: if I take Xyrem, will I hear my baby crying at night? Maybe not, because especially during the two first hours of the drug, there is an hypoarousability. So make sure you have a partner or a family to help when during the night. And same thing for sleep drunkenness. Now, it's one of my patients said, when I sleep, I have two little girls, when I sleep on the sofa in the living room for my scheduled nap, I need this nap, really, I need it. And my two daughters come and disturb me. They want to play, I want to sleep. I get angry with them, and then I regret being angry. I feel guilty, and this is very typical. You feel guilty to sleep in front of your children at time they want you. So what would you answer to Marion? There's a little problem when you see the figure here. Where is she sleeping? Yeah, on the sofa. And yeah, the living room is the common room. Some little children understand that you are available for them. So sleep in the bedroom for privacy and explain to your children that your naps are mom therapy. So now she sleeps in her bedroom and she has no fight with the little girls because she's sleeping. The door is closed and she's sleeping and they should not disturb. Menopauses occur also, and I have only a single slide. Menopausal hormonal therapy consists of estrogen and progestin at lower dosage than for birth control, but we have the same problem. So you need to double the dosage if you are on modafinil. Like, for example, if you take one press of estrogen, usually you prescribe that. If you're on modafinil, you take two press. You see? So this is to finish. This is my family, father's side, and there were some birth control, but we like children. Thank you very much.
So I have been on, I started with Ritalin, and I had bad side effects along with modafinil and armodafinil. And now I'm on Ritalin, or Adderall.
Yeah,
so I'm wondering if I had bad side effects taking both modafinil and armodafinil with the hormonal changes of being pregnant, like could I have a better effect going on that when I'm pregnant potentially? Like does the hormone potentially make it better?
No. If you had a side effect with modafinil, you will still have them during pregnancy. So no. Better not taking anything. It's usually because we are using modafinil and it works, but not very well. So we are switching the patient to something else in routine. So when it comes to pregnancy, you can restart it if it had worked before, even if it was not big.
But thank you. Do you schedule C-sections? Because if they're get off medication for like 2 weeks before, what if the baby comes early or is late?
No.
So it's still natural delivery?
It's still natural, and as you've seen, there are no higher C-section rate in patients with hypersomnia. So it's just that 2 weeks is a very, very safe zone because modafinil is eliminated within 7 days, so it's to be sure because you can have premature birth.
Michelle? Do you see a correlation for your patients that have IH also having menstrual headaches?
No, but I think I didn't ask very well. We look at pain in general. In patients with IH and with narcolepsy, as you know, it's increased in narcolepsy, it's known, and we have the same rate of pain in IH. So it seems that being sleepy increases your pain in general. But we have not yet gone in detail of is your hypersomnia symptom increasing at time of premenstruation, or does it change during pregnancy? Nothing serious to answer you, but I think it's an interesting project to do in the future.